Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Maybe you misunderstood me. I said, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Everybody, please stand up and join us for some songs.
Oh,
seat, everybody. Do you entrust your life to God the Father?
I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you entrust your life to Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead, and on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you entrust your life to the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We believe.
We believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death, we believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back.
Now, a certain man fell ill, Lazarus, from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This was the Mary who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother, Lazarus, was ill. So the sisters sent to Jesus, saying,
Lord, the friend you love is ill.
When Jesus heard it, he said,
This illness doesn't end in death, but in the glory of God, so the Son of God may be glorified through it.
Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Still, when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed where he was 2 days more. Then after that, he said to his disciples,
Let's go to Judea.
Rabbi, people in Judea want to stone us, and you're taking us there again?
Aren't there 12 hours of daylight? If people walk in the daylight, they don't stumble because they don't see the light of this world. But if they go walking at night, they do stumble because there is no light in them. Lazarus, our friend, has fallen asleep, but I'm heading there to waken him.
Lord, if he's asleep, he's going to be saved.
Lazarus died, and I'm happy for your sake that I wasn't there. This way, you might believe. So, let's go to him.
When Martha heard that Jesus was arriving, she went to greet him. Mary sat in the house.
Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Yet I know that whatever you ask God, God will give you.
Your brother will rise again.
I know he will be raised at the resurrection on the last day.
I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever entrusts their life to me, even though they should die, yet they will live. And everyone who is alive and entrusts their life to me shall not die in the age to come. Do you believe this?
Yes, Lord. I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world.
We believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death, we believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe.
Thank you.
religious leaders with Mary in the house comforting her. They saw Mary get up and go out, and they followed her, assuming she was headed to the tomb to be well there. But when Mary got to where Jesus was, she saw him and fell at his feet, saying,
"Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died."
Jesus saw her bewailing, and the religious leaders who had come with her also bewailing. He groaned in his spirit. He was stirred up.
"Where have you laid him?"
"Sir, come and see."
Jesus teared up and began to weep.
"We believe."
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe."
So they lifted away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said,
"Lift the stone away." Martha, sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, he smells bad. It's been 4 days."
"Did I not say to you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?"
So they lifted away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said,
"Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Indeed, I have always known that you hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing around, so that they might believe you have sent me. Lazarus, come out."
The dead man came out, bound foot and hand with strips of cloth, and his face was wrapped with a face cloth.
"Unbind him and let him go on his way."
Amen. We believe. In this time of this.
We believe in God the Father. Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. Consider
this your week, your belief is put into action.
Let's all stand up and sing a song. And you might know some of this song.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, we believe. the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the cross of redemption. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back, coming back again. Coming back again.
We know that 2016 unfolded as the worst year on record for worldwide Christian persecution, with the highest rate of believers put to death because of their belief in Jesus as Christ, as our Savior. For those who remain, each day they must put their belief into action as they live under a constant umbrella of threat. You may not be under such a threat, but applying your faith in today's world is no less challenging. Do I get sucked up by other people's gossip, or do I disengage and refuse to contribute? Do I get enraged by yet another political rant of the day? Do I allow myself to get enmeshed in other people's problems, thinking that I'm helping but only making things worse? Do I allow myself to be conflicted between doing that which I know is right but end up taking the easiest way out? Do I recognize a need where God can use me, but it explains away because I'm simply too busy? Do I compromise my own convictions over social wrongs in fear that I will rock the boat? The list goes on. We know that we believe, but acting on what we believe is yet another story. Believe.
Yes, we have some important announcements, and we have these over here as well. Did you get that? Hey, we had the United Methodist Women had a fundraiser last night. We had a live auction. We had a silent auction. Hi, you too.
And Dave, you're still alive.
And we're all still healthy and well. Charlotte, would you like to say something about that? Did we make some money?
We'd like to thank everyone for coming, and all those who donated. I'm going to hit pay. We made almost $3,000 for our mission, and we just thank everybody. And of course, Dave did a miraculous job, and Jeff and Pam and Peggy handled the kitchen, and we actually made money on the food. And I'd like to invite all the women to our meeting this coming month. It'll be on the 20th, the third Thursday. Last month, we had a young man talk to us about drug addiction, and this month, his mother is going to talk to us about how she handled his drug addiction. So that'll be on the 20th at 6:30 for potluck, 7:15 for the service, and we'd like for all the ladies to plan on attending. Thank you, and thank you for our auction.
You got some more there, Dave?
Yeah, I got a lot of announcements. I do want to... welcome everybody. I see some faces I only see on Easter and Christmas, not even you, gentlemen. So it's a really rare occasion here.
Is that the cheesy Goodwin there somewhere in the house?
Some important announcements for the youth here. The second camp payments are due. So if your kids are going to summer camps with the work groups, now's a good time to pay for that. This is a really important one. This Friday through Saturday is our lock-in for the youth. So if you want your children to be locked away, bring them here on Friday evening. Grayson, what time does that start?
7
o'clock Friday evening. You can drop them off here and not pick them up till Well, like a week, you could. The next day. Okay, well, so you get a whole night off. That's good.
Don't tease. Well,
Pam wants to know if she can drop her husband off. All right, so also very important, no youth group on April 9th or April 16th.
Because of the overnight and Easter.
Well, yeah. One's overnight and the next one's an Easter. Okay, yeah I got you. Very important, Derby Day tickets are on sale now. That's a fundraiser. Grayson's waving the tickets in the air. So see Grayson, there's a fundraising. It's going to be a lot of fun.
It's going to be a great meal, lots of fun and activity.
It's not a soapbox derby. It's the Kentucky Derby is what they're celebrating there. So they're having a contest, so buy your tickets from Kim. And number five, Dave is the best.
All right. Thank you, Dave. Everybody agree that Dave's the best? All right. Just a reminder, we're doing the, anybody interested in confirmation, we're doing some makeup days today and next Sunday. Also next Sunday is the cantata at 8 o'clock and 11 o'clock. It's great. A musical performance and that our choir and combined choirs and all are contribute to. So make sure you're there. But also after the confirmation, we'll have a member orientation, meaning you just want to know more about the church and how you can be involved and how you can serve your Lord and act out your faith. You're welcome to come to that as well. And those are in our handouts of the specific times for those, because at this point, I got too much clockwork going in my head. All right. Now, it's good to see you, Chris. God bless you. Life Tree this week is about those who are suffering the aftermath of suicide. So if that's close to your heart, if you or need to be aware of more of that, please come Thursday evening for that event. And let's see, I know I'm missing. Oh, yes, and one more thing. Last week, on Monday, we sent representatives from our church, Reverend Linda and Kathy Smith, to take part in the West County Chamber of Commerce recognition. And they've been doing this every year. They recognize, you know, the teacher of the year and the police officer of the year and things of that nature. And we were nominated, and we, along with one other nominee, and we won the nomination for the best partnership, business partnership in West County. Odenton Elementary awarded us that. Along with numerous certificates from the county and the state, and this recognition here, you all, when you come up for communion, you can take a look at it. But I think that's pretty significant. Be out of all those who contribute greatly to this community, this is actually the first time they've awarded this particular award, and so we are at the top of the pack in service to our community. We thank God for that. We thank God for you, because all the things you do for Backpack Buddies, Confident Kids. We bought bookshelves for their library. We've helped sponsor their daily, their weekly handouts. I mean, do name it. We've had a part in enriching these children's lives, and from tutoring to just hands-on, personal, and for the glory of God. Thank you. God bless you. I think that's all I got, Dave.
Okay, let's take this opportunity to stand up and greet one another.
doing good.
Good, good. I'm glad to hear that. Russ, how are you?
Excellent.
I like these responses. What about you? But when you know when these niceties are exchanged when we greet one another, when you ask somebody, how are you, do you really want to know how they are? Because typically, you know, they say, I'm doing fine. You know, they give you like a thumbs up or a okay or something of that nature, right? You know, because they're just being polite. Because they, you know, because how are you is kind of a loaded question, isn't it?
It can be.
It can be, because how are you feeling, Roy?
Fiddle's a fiddle,
but how are you feeling, Roy?
Fantastic.
But how are you, those feelings within you about, you know, I won't get into that. Because you know, if you ask somebody how they feel, how they really feel, it's like popping the cork, and sometimes it's, once you shook up the bottle and you pop it, and it all just kind of fizzes out, it's hard to get it all back in, right? That gets a little messy, doesn't it? And if you ask about work and your professional life, well, they really don't want to know what I feel about my boss, right? You ask about family, well, you know, I'm not really going to share with the attitude of my teenage daughter or my son, right? You see, it can go on. Do they really want to, when you ask, how are you, do you really want to know what they're feeling? Or are you just being nice? Being nice. And it's nice to have niceness in the world, because we see a lot of rudeness, don't we? We see a lot of people kind of treating people brutally, and we see people being anything but kind, but we still have that sense of courtesy in our culture that we at least try to be appropriate when somebody greets us. But how are you spiritually? When was the last time, John, anybody asked you how you're doing spiritually?
Just now.
Yeah. Exactly. And sometimes that might make someone a little uncomfortable, because in our culture you don't ask about such things, do you? How's your religious life going?
Good.
Yeah, good. Hallelujah. And, you know, people get a little uneasy when you start talking about that, because you know, one of the things you don't talk about in polite culture is politics and religion, right? And we've been trained to that. And it's getting a little personal. What business is it of someone how I'm doing spiritually? But you see, that's just what Jesus Christ did. He got personal. He wasn't interested in pat colloquial replies. He certainly wasn't satisfied with canned religious talking points either. He constantly pressed his disciples to greater depths of understanding, chiseling away at their character. So he could only do so because over time he established and he built trust and confidence with them. In other words, when Jesus said he was going to do something, he did it over and over again. So they knew that whenever Jesus said something, they had the confidence it would come to pass, even if it seemed implausible, if not impossible. Of course, Jesus did all he did to come to prepare them for what was yet to come. And that's the importance of this story about the death of his good friend Lazarus. Pardon the cartoon, but somebody's hitting the joke.
Okay. Yeah. That would have been a lot more impressive, by the
way. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Now, it's one thing feeding multiple thousands with a few fish and a couple loaves of bread. It was another thing to witness Jesus walking on the water and calming the storm. And yet another thing to see him heal those with lifelong diseases and impairments. And yet another to see him exorcise evil from those possessed. But this was Lazarus. This was their friend. This was about as close up and personal as it could get. It appeared that when Jesus heard the news of his illness, he was rather nonchalant. Huh. And I'm sure the disciples took Jesus' delayed response as an indicator that everything was okay. Then after waiting 2 days, Jesus decides to return to Judea under the protest of his disciples. All they could envision was that they were going to walk into a trap set up by Jesus' enemies. Sometimes it's difficult to understand what Jesus meant, let alone what he was up to. Have you all had problems with that with people in your lives? Understanding what they mean or what they're up to? Right? What is his motive? What is he getting? Why would he want to do this? And he basically tells them not to worry about it. Don't worry about things that don't need to be worried about. He's the light of the world, so they have nothing to fear. Then Jesus switches gears altogether. Have you ever been with people that done that? I know Kim does that with me all the time. What are you talking about? He says, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep. I go to awaken him. Now Jesus is speaking in riddles. If Lazarus is asleep, why such sudden urgency? You all have that when people have said, I got to go now. And you wonder why the urgency is there. I can see them shaking their heads in bewilderment. Has anyone ever had to explain something to you multiple times before you to get it? Amen. All right. As long as, I'll say that again. Have you ever? Never mind. As long as the disciples were with Jesus, you'd think that they would have been caught up and spun up onto Jesus' nuances by now. But again, Jesus has to clarify what he meant. He says, Lazarus has died. And for your sake, when he says that, he's pointing to you. For your sake, I'm glad that I was not there so that you may believe. There's that term belief again. But let us go to him. But they still weren't getting it. Because Thomas, in exasperation, retorted, well, let us also go, then we all might die with him. Have you ever had somebody that just likes to get negative about stuff? Right? Thomas, you remember doubting Thomas later on, right? And here he is, the skeptic. Yeah, let's just all die with him. So they were not necessarily going with the best attitude. Have any of you gone through difficult times and not had the best attitude? Right? Yeah, okay. So before I go on, let's look how this account further applies to you. Have you ever wondered why God didn't take something as serious as you think you should take? Have you ever wondered why God tarries, why he appears to be operating on his own time clock and not yours? And the more he delays, the more frustrated you become? You had not? Yeah. Have you ever pondered what God is getting you into? Have you ever got frustrated why God seems to be making things so difficult? Have you ever questioned what the purpose of this hardship or trial is? And do you ever wonder if God feels the same thing you're feeling? If so, then you're right on board with the disciples. And this story is for you. In this narrative, all these questions are addressed and even more. You see, the application was not just to the disciples, nor was it just to Mary and Martha, or to the crowd that witnessed the event. The application's for you too. Even though the disciples were clueless, Jesus stated the bluff. Anybody know what bluff means? Where's our military folk? Randy. Bottom line up front. Yes. He stated the bottom line up front. He said this. It is for the glory of God. The answer to all those questions we just talked about, all right? It's for the glory of God. And for so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Huh. I never thought about it that way. I mean, the stuff that I'm going through is for the glory of God. I mean, I just want to be blessed, right, Roy? You just want to be blessed. You don't think about, is it going to glorify God or not? You just, I just like being blessed. How many here came here not expecting, or let's say, expecting not to be blessed? This entire scenario, from the parent delay to entering into the hostile territory to the raising of Lazarus from the dead some 4 days after his death. How many have ever been accused of being, I'm going to just say this, Roy, because you do a lot of hard labor, right?
Foot dragging.
Yeah, foot dragging. Yeah. Has anybody said you stink?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, all right. Now, Lazarus really stunk. And he'd been in that, wrapped up in those claws, stuck it away in a tomb for 4 days. Not good. All of this was to demonstrate the limitless power of God in our lives, no matter the circumstance, no matter how stinky it is, no matter how smelly or how dire it may appear. You see, you can doubt all you want. You can fear all you want. You can worry all you want. And some of you do a pretty good job of that. You shake your head, right? But God wants you to know that you don't have to doubt. You don't have to worry. And you definitely don't have to fear. I want to hear an amen to that. Because, you know, whether you do or you don't, God always gives you the choice to believe. He gives you the choice to believe. In fact, Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there so that you may believe. Jesus needed to make sure in the near term that these disciples were ready for Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday. And this was a stepping stone in tempering and strengthening of their faith. It was one thing to witness a miracle of someone that they didn't know or had no connection with, but their deep abiding friendship with Lazarus and his sisters made this too close to home. There had to be no shadow of doubt that Lazarus was dead beyond recovery and not had just lapsed in some sort of coma which Jesus could easily revive him from. The presenting scenario was deemed impossible and hopeless. Therefore, God could demonstrate that nothing was impossible for him. This instance was the pinnacle of the foundation of belief that God had been building and constructing in their lives. Now, if you go in the original Greek, you see that word, it's pisteo, something. Gus, can you give me a good pronunciation of that? Yeah, pisteo, all right, yeah. All right, turn to your partner and say pisteo, but don't do it and spit it on there. It's kind of one of those spitting kind of words, but pisteo, right? To believe, right? You see, in the original Greek, pisteo means more than attestation of knowledge of something or someone. You see, I don't know about you, but Lois, do you know George Washington? Do you know George Washington? Have you ever met George Washington? No, okay. Reed, have you ever met George Washington?
Only on the front of a bill.
Only on the front of a bill, right? You know, yeah, exactly. So I can attest that I know George Washington, but I don't know him personally. I mean, I've been taught that he was the first president, that he was the father of our country, that I've been to Mount Vernon. I could even stay overnight at Mount Vernon, but doesn't mean I personally know George Washington. You see, that's the difference between attestation and true belief. Our belief in Jesus is more than attesting to the stories that were told about him in the gospel. It's more than the traditions of the church. It's more than the doctrines and the theologies contrived over the centuries. Belief is not just being acquainted with Jesus. But we know him personally and know that he knows us by name. The pastor may forget my name. My husband may even forget my name. My children may forget my name. My wife may forget my name. But Jesus will never forget my name. For my name, Scripture tells us, is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Permanently encoded. That's personal. This means we know what he claims about his about himself is undeniably true. Now, an example of this is found in Jesus' discussion with Martha, Lazarus' sister. You can tell, though, being polite, Martha made it clear to Jesus that if he had come earlier, Lazarus would never have died, and and all this grief would be unnecessary. Have you ever told anybody, if you only been there, a little guilt on them? Well, I mean, this is kind of Mary's kind of making it known her disappointment to Jesus, and all the same, her attitude was, if it is what it is, and if Jesus wanted to fix this, God through him would make it happen. But here's the next point for you. When Jesus assured her that her brother would rise again, Martha responded with a theologically correct answer. How many of us have done that? Oh, it must be God's will. Do we really believe that? Or we just say it kind of as a false sense of comfort? Right? This was her theologically correct answer. I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on that last day. But Jesus pressed back, because it wasn't just enough to have the right answer. There's plenty of people who can quote chapter and verse. He tasked her as to whether she actually believed what she was spouting off. I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall they live. And whoever and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And this is what he says. Straighten her eye. Do you believe this? And so the question courses through time to you. Do you believe this? Or is it something you've always heard, were taught and recited at and affirmed at your baptismal or membership vows? Do you attest to this as something that you know and you're aware of, or do you believe beyond an intellectual acknowledgement? For Mary, this was her turning point. She was moved from attesting of something she was aware of to claiming something that she was sure of. Huh, I like that. Attesting to something she was aware of to claiming something she was sure of. That's belief. Yes, Lord, she said, I believe that you are Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. And when demonstrated and acted on, belief can be infectious. Lazarus was not the only beneficiary of this miracle. Each one of the disciples, Martha and Mary, even the skeptical public who criticized and ridiculed Jesus, experienced the power of belief and witnessed the wonder of God's might and glory. And so this is the point of the story. That you may believe God sent Jesus to work his power in you and demonstrate his glory in you. It's not about being blessed beyond all expression. Is about God demonstrating his glory. And you, have you thought about how God is going to demonstrate his glory in you this week? So how are you really doing? When we endure a crisis, we often think God is distant or far away. How many, when you have something go wrong, you think God's not even close by? He must be another planet somewhere, you know, taking care of somebody there. And surely it must be, for if he was close, he wouldn't let me suffer as I'm suffering right now. But we see here that not only was Jesus aware, but Jesus experienced the same grief we experience during loss in life. For it says here in the shortest verse in all of Scripture, Jesus wept. God feels what you feel. He created feelings, so he knows what it's like. So the next time you think God is far away and doesn't care, think again. Jesus cares more than you'll ever know. It's all personal to Jesus. And Jesus desires more than anything that you'll know him personally. And that's why he died for you in the first place, so that you can be with him forever. It's very personal for him. So going back to where we started, do you really believe? Your answer? Now, I added a little extra to this because there was a thought in my mind that sometimes, do any of you ever doubt on what you believe? Or are things coming the way and just kind of push your belief to a side? I heard this, I've heard it before, I'm sure, but it resonated with me as I was doing my walking devotionals. And it's by Casting Crowns, and it just says, just be held. I'm not going to read the whole song to you, but I'm going to read what counts. It says, when you're tired of fighting, chained by your control, there's freedom in surrender. Lay it down and let go. If your eyes are on the storm, you'll wonder if I love you still. But if your eyes are on the cross, you'll know I always have, and I always will. And not a tear is wasted. In time, you'll understand, I'm painting beauty with the ashes. Your life is in my hands. Lift your hands, lift your eyes. In the storm is where you'll find me. And where you are, I'll hold your heart. Come to me. Find your rest in the arms of the God who won't let go. And here's the chorus. So when you're on your knees and the answer seems so, so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart. It's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be held. Stop holding on and just be held. Do you believe? Do you believe? And so, as a more than an attestation, but a confirmation of what you believe, a meal is provided to remind you of what Jesus said he would do, he did for you. So as you receive this meal, you can be assured that you don't have to hold on. You only need to be held. I ask you now to join with me in this great Thanksgiving, remembering that the Lord is with you. And he's going to skip over, okay? And also with you, please lift up your eyes. Bless the Lord. Praised in heaven, praised in earth, praised throughout your creation in your name, holy triune God. The trees of the field rejoice in your salvation. The stars shine out their glory. Winds and waters scatter the sound of your voice. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in your name. Hosanna in the highest. And blessed are you, Jesus Christ, way and truth, resurrection and life, calling disciples and making friends among us. It's personal. And you ask us to believe, to entrust our lives to you, God's first begotten, that we, with you, may rise in the midst of this mortal life and into the age to come. Vanquisher of death, giver of life, thank you for coming among us and offering yourself in this holy meal to lift every barrier, to call us out from every tomb and set us free from all that binds us. With your disciples, with those first disciples on the night of your betrayal, and into death, you took the bread. You blessed it. You broke it and gave it, saying, take eat, this is my body given for you. And then you took the cup. Gave thanks and gave it, saying, drink this,
here and now, come Holy Spirit. Come upon these gifts and upon us. Make them be for us Christ's body and blood, that we who receive them may be for all the body of Christ made alive by his blood. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Make us whole and holy on this day as we await the day when we shall feast with Christ in that new creation. To Christ, to you, and all merciful Creator, one God, living and true, be all praise and honor and glory now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of all God's children, let us pray that prayer which Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As in the ancient tradition of the church and of Christ's time itself, they took the bread and they dipped it in the cup and received both elements simultaneously. And so we are offering communion this way this morning. I ask you to come forward. I will have the station that has the gluten-free alternative. The rest will be regular wafers. So let's see. Grayson, can you get me about three people up here, please? Grizz, you want to come help? Come on up, Grizz.
And I think I saw Abby here. Abby Barnett.
He's upstairs. Yeah. Please come. Believe as you receive.
Precious blood of
and join us for one last song. And if you forgot, there's baskets at the front here. You can deposit your tithes and offerings in those baskets.
There we go. Come on.
Happy birthday, dear Chris and Abby. Happy birthday.
to lock in your kids next Friday.